Hi, it's Skiffin Labates here, and today's video is an answer to a question asked by Tanya Matveeva in a comment to one of my previous videos where I explained that Bitcoin proof of work is not the solving of a complex cryptographic puzzle. It's not complex and it's not a puzzle. Her question was, proof of work uses SHA256, a cryptographic hash function. Why is it that particular function that is used, and could another one be used? And the answer to the second part of that question is yes, any cryptographic hash function could be used in Bitcoin proof of work, provided it satisfies a number of conditions, and they actually are all meant to. So the conditions that a hash function is meant to satisfy, the main one that's significant to proof of work is that it's irreversible. You can't deduce the input given the output, because if you could reverse it, then what you could do is you could see that the difficulty says you need a hash output that's smaller than a certain number, so you would just pick a number that's smaller than that number and generate the required block backwards from that. So you can't do that with cryptographic hash functions. You feed the data in, you get the output out, but it's not reversible. They're also called trapdoor functions because of this. And the second thing is that they should be random number generators or pseudo-random number generators. The output should have no bearing on the input, so you can't skew it towards a particular size of number. And in fact, it's probably helpful if they're uniformly distributed pseudo-random number generators. That just means that the odds of any particular number coming out of the function is equal to the odds of any other number coming out. And it's not skewed towards mid-sized numbers or small numbers or big numbers. And then the final thing is there should be a reasonable level of computation required to run the function, but not too much. You're meant to be able to verify the hash fairly quickly, or very quickly, but computing millions upon millions of the hashes should take a significant amount of time. And SHA-256 does this. Now, there are other hash functions out there that also could be used. For example, Blake is another one. Kekak, which is actually used in Ethereum, is another one. But there's a reason why Nakamoto picked SHA-256. And that is because SHA-256 is one of a number of cryptographic hash functions in a family of hash functions called SHA-2. SHA just stands for Secure Hash Algorithm. And at the point that Nakamoto was coding up Bitcoin, SHA-2 was the state-of-the-art hash function, although it was coming to the end of its life, because in 2008, I believe, they started a competition to find SHA-3, the third generation of secure hashing algorithms. And the winner for that was selected in 2012. So that was too late for it to be selected as the hashing algorithm for Bitcoin. I imagine if either SHA-3 had been settled on 4 or 5 years earlier, or if Bitcoin had taken 4 or 5 years longer to be produced, then we probably would have been using a SHA-3 hashing algorithm. Similarly, I imagine Nakamoto didn't select any in the SHA-1 family of hashing algorithms because they were already old by that time and some vulnerabilities had been found. And there's an even earlier family of cryptographic hash functions from the 80s, the RIPE-MD, or RIPE Message Digest functions. And actually, RIPE-MD-160 is used in the generation of Bitcoin addresses, but that's an aside. So it's been a bit of a lightning tour over secure hashing algorithms or cryptographic hashing algorithms. I think I've answered the question, but if I haven't done so fully, feel free to ask more questions in the comments of this video. Hope you've all found this interesting, and see you in the next one soon. Bye for now.